Hi, everyone, and welcome to the Canadian Artistic Food Expo. My name is Alf de Blasius, your host for this virtual event. I will be introducing some of the wonderful guests that are joining us today, but let me introduce myself first. I was a television producer for many years on multilingual networks like Omni and TLN TV. I've also been a reporter, a magazine editor, podcaster, and voiceover artist. I've had an opportunity to work in various sectors of media, and I've also had the good fortune to contribute to projects like this one. I was one of the hosts of the Toronto Food Expo, which was held as a virtual event last year. Throughout my career, I've had a chance to interact with many chefs and culinary experts, including television personalities I'm sure you're all familiar with, like Lydia Bastianich, David Rocco, Craig Harding, and Rob Rossi. And currently, I operate my own consulting service, providing content creation and communication solutions to a variety of businesses. But that's enough about me. Let's learn a little bit about what to expect today. On August 6th, we staged our first in-person event organized in Belleville. We'd like to acknowledge the support of the city and all the celebrity chefs who were present, Chef Massimo Capra, Chef Reem Ahmed, Chef Luciano Schipano, Chef David Wolfman, Chef Suman Ali, and the chefs from My Sister's Table. It was a wonderful celebrity-filled event with more than 35 vendors, along with many eminent dignitaries. We want to thank the Honorable MPP Todd Smith, Councillor Carol Feeney, and Councillor Bill Sanderson for their support in attending the event. One of the highlights of the event was the participation of 20 immigrant women who showcased their culinary skills. Thank you to all who joined us in person. Understanding that it was not possible for everyone to travel, we organized today's virtual event. I'd like to take a moment to share some information about the organizers. Saffron Hub is a national nonprofit organization established to support and promote women food entrepreneurs throughout Canada. Saffron Hub believes in inclusion, empowerment, and collective impact through innovative and need-based programs and services where poverty is reduced, equity is achieved, and community collaboration is possible for the betterment of our communities. The Artists and Artisans Development and Network was founded in 2014 to provide resources and community development for artists and artisans who are immigrants to Canada. They started by helping artists participate in community festivals to promote and showcase their work and have since grown their community and program offerings. They now work with over 500 artists in over 112 languages, helping them access cultural and economic opportunities. Finally, a big thank you to Loyalist College, Belleville Nissan, Liuna Local 183, the City of Belleville, the City of Brampton, and Alexicon for sponsoring this event. Having local organizations support our entrepreneurs, small businesses, and female chefs means a lot, and we appreciate everything our sponsors have done for us to make this event possible. Now, let's kick things off with the phenomenal Chef Nui Regular. Chef Nui is the executive chef and co-owner of Pai, Kin, Bai Chef Nui, Sabai Sabai, and Sukotai, and executive chef of Silva. She has transformed the Thai food scene in Toronto through the distinct flavors of Northern Thai cuisine and hospitality. It all began when Chef Nui opened the humble curry shack in the small town of Pai in Northern Thailand. You may have seen her at our Toronto Artistic Food Expo. She's currently a resident judge on Food Network Canada's Wall of Chefs. She's the recipient of the 2022 American Express Award for Business Leadership. Her debut cookbook, Kin, Recipes and Stories from Northern Thailand, won a 2021 IACP Cookbook Award and a Taste Canada Gold Award.
สวัสดีค่ะ. Hi, I'm Chef Nui Regula, Executive Chef and co-owner of Pai, Sukhothai, Kin and Sawa Restaurant in Toronto. I'm so happy to be here today for Canadian Artistic Food Expo. And today I'm gonna show us a very simple way to make a delicious Thai salad called papaya salad, or in Thai we call som tam. So papaya salad is a very, very famous dish in Thailand during the summertime. Green papaya different from the ripe papaya because the inside of green papaya, it has a white color like this, which is in Thailand, we use it for our salad. The ingredient for making papaya salad is very simple. We have papaya, we're gonna have some of this tomato. So you can use either cherry tomato, grape tomato, or Roma tomato. The spice that we use red bird eye chili, which is look like this. So the red bird eye chili is very spicy. For those that you don't like spicy salad, you can use less of the chili, which is used at the bottom half or medium. Or if you don't like spicy at all, you can just leave out the chili. The flavor of papaya salad, so you'll be used with the garlic, will be our a nice aroma and a little bit of the spicy in papaya salad as well. In Thailand, we use a special equipment which is called motan pestle like this to pow and making sauce for the salad. Those of you that don't have motan pestle like this at home, you can use a simple bowl to mix them as well. The ingredients that very key in the papaya sauce will be the sour, which is this come from lime juice, and also in Thailand we use a tamarind paste as well. So then you have a very, very tart and a little bit of sharp of the acidic from the lime juice with the sweet. So in Thailand we use a lot of coconut sugar for our salad. But if you don't have coconut sugar at home, you can use brown sugar, or you can use either like a cane sugar or white sugar. It's okay as well. So now we have sour, we have sweet, and the next thing in the component of the papaya salad sauce is the salt. So in papaya salad, we use fish sauce, which is you can find in any Asian market. Also with some of you that don't eat fish sauce, or you want to make it in the vegan version, you can use salt instead of fish sauce as well. To simply making papaya salad sauce, you can add lime juice and tamarind paste. So you can, tamarind it's sometimes of the, you can buy it from Asian store, or you can make your own tamarind paste by boiling tamarind seedless with the water, scrub it and to make the tamarind paste. Or you can get a bottle that you can find in any of the Asian store. And then mix them together, add sugar and fish sauce. So normally in my cookbook, which is I have in front of you here called Gin. It's a story and recipe from Not Enough Thailand. So you can find a recipe how to make papaya salad in that book as well. I will ask you to mix between the fish sauce and sugar first, because coconut sugar sometimes is very, very thick, and it's hard to dilute it to sauce. But this one I use the brown sugar, so it's okay to add it together and mix to the papaya salad sauce like this. In Thailand, we add some vegetable in papaya salad as well. So aside from the green papaya or the tomato, we add green beans. So the green bean that we use is different from regular green bean that you find in the market, because it's called yard long bean. We cut it into about 1 inches. And also this one here we call sawtooth coriander. It have a little bit of the texture. When you bite it, it have a very nice aroma into papaya salad. And this one, we dice it into about 1 inch long like this as well. So if you don't have green bean or sawtooth, you can just leave it out, it's okay as well. If you find a green papaya like this in a market, so to use this one, normally very simple, you can just peel the skin off using a peeler or using a sharp knife. So sometimes if you don't have green papaya at home, something that I would recommend during this summertime, you can use green apple. Very fun summer salad. So for this one, I'm gonna wash them and then pat dry. So after wash and pat dry, normally in Thailand, we use different way of preparing it. We chop, chop, chop using a knife like this, but this way it's a traditional way. I won't recommend you to do it because it might be dangerous. But again, this one, it's a traditional way. So we just slide them down like this after you chop them up. Also, if you don't do this way, so easy way to do this is like, you can just slide this one up, very thin. After that, slide them up and julienne them. So basically we just make it like very nice julienne. So it looks like this. Similar way of using the knife to chop, or if you have any tool that you can use for grater, you can use that as well. So the long strip or mandolin. So now, because tradition, so we use mortar and pestle to do the dry part. So in the papaya salad, I said the aroma of the papaya, it's using with this one, the garlic. So I'm gonna put garlic in and grind it first using mortar and pestle. So this way, 2 minutes until it has fine mint and has a beautiful garlic flavor in here. Or if you don't have this at home, you can just use your knife to dice, to mince this garlic. It's the same thing as well. And then with the spicy, so if you like spicy, you can use the whole piece of the bird eye chili, but remove the stem out. Be careful when you make papaya salad with the fresh chili, because sometimes it jump into your eye, so just make your eyes smaller, so there's a smaller target, and then use your hand to cover them. Okay, so next, after this, if you use the green bean, so add green bean in and bruise them a little bit. So to bruise them, then allow the sauce to absorb more. And after this, you will add tomato. So I dice tomato in half. So this way it can have some of the juice come out to give a little bit of umami in the salad itself. So if you like peanut, you can add the roasted peanut at this time, but because I'm at home cooking for you, but my daughter has allergic to peanut, so that's why today I wouldn't add peanut into my papaya salad. Oftentimes you can find that Thai people use dry shrimp, which is this dry small little shrimp like this. We add it into our papaya salad. And this dry shrimp you can find anywhere in the Asian market. If you don't have it, you can just don't add it, it's okay as well. So today I'm gonna add a little bit of this dry shrimp into my papaya salad. So now you mix all the vegetable that we added in, and now we're gonna add our sauce that we prepared. So I'm gonna add a little bit first because the lime juice has a and tamarind has a different flavor of the acidic. So we just go by taste. So if you add a little bit, and then to see if you need more, you can add, squeeze some more lime juice in there. So now next will be add shredded papaya that you have. So you can add, I will add the whole thing. And now the technique is I use the mortar and pestle to lightly bruise them. So not break or like too small pieces, just lightly bruise. So this way it's allow the fresh of the papaya to absorb the flavors. Oh, my mouth is so watering right now because it smells so good here with a little bit of garlic and spice. the chili and the tomato. So now these papaya salad, I would recommend it that when you prepare them, just serve them right away, because if you leave it for a little bit longer, the flavor will change, acidity will drop. So that's why make sure that you mix and make papaya salad just right before you're gonna serve. Look at the wonderful color of the Thai salad. That's very easy to make it at home. So this is your papaya salad. In Thailand, we eat papaya salad with the fresh vegetable like cabbage, which is this one. I cut it in two wedges, so then you can have a very crispy sweet of this. Or if you have with the lettuce at home, you can use lettuce to wrap and eat your papaya as well. Enjoy, and thank you very much for watching. ขอบคุณค่ะ
Thank you very much, Chef Nui, for that lovely recipe. Our next guest is Chef Karen Devaux. Chef Karen began her culinary career in Toronto in the mid-90s and honed her skills in some of the city's finest restaurants, including Ivory, Borgo Antico, Rosewater Supper Club, Winston's, and the Left Bank. From there, she transitioned into high-end catering and eventually became a private chef for a prominent family. Karen moved to Prince Edward County in 2003 to open the Milford Bistro, Harvest, and Pinch Gourmet with her partner, Michael Potters. Their businesses worked with local producers and winemakers to celebrate seasonality and terroir through food and service. Karen began teaching in the culinary program at Loyalist College in 2010 and takes great pride in her current role of coordinator and full-time professor. Together with her team, she weaves creativity, excellence, sustainability, and wellness into the program that they share with aspiring chefs of the future. Additionally, Karen leads a team of officiants who perform wedding ceremonies in Southern Ontario through her company, Weddings by Karen.
I'm Chef Karen Devaux. I am the program coordinator of the culinary programs here at Loyalist College. My background started in Toronto, so I went to George Brown College. Out of college, I ended up in some amazing fine dining restaurants, so including Ivory, Left Bank. I was part of the opening crew of Rosewater. I cooked at Winston's for a period of time, and all of those fine dining rooms were an incredible foundation for my culinary trainings. From there, I went on to cook for some prominent families as a private chef. And then following that, I ended up moving out to Prince Edward County in 2003 to open some restaurants. So started with a tiny restaurant called the Milford Bistro. That was 18 seats in a converted general store. We did two seatings every night. It was absolute madness, but really focused on seasonal ingredients, local ingredients. From there, I moved on to open a larger restaurant in Picton called Harvest Restaurant that was rated one of Canada's top 10 dining rooms by En Route magazine. And there, we really augmented our efforts around local. From there, I moved on to teach here at the college. So I started part-time and then ended up becoming full-time faculty and just learning to translate my knowledge from the industry into a teaching position, which has been incredibly rewarding. Throughout my time in Toronto, I was probably the only woman in the majority of the kitchens that I worked at. And so this sort of absence of females in the kitchen, I think largely had to do with a number of factors. So A, it's a very physically demanding job, but B, there are some social constructs that prevent women from coming to the industry and staying in the industry. So lots of evenings, lots of long hours, weekends. And if the female is, you know, the person who's traditionally doing the childcare or responsible for domestic work, a lot of that becomes really challenging to pursue on a meaningful professional level. I think that in my own case, I was really fortunate to have the support of my father. So when I opened my businesses, Papa came and played double duty in terms of looking after our daughter and helping to support us in the restaurant by, you know, going to all the farms and picking up all the things. But the role of women in the kitchen has definitely shifted over time. And now we're seeing, you know, if not 50%, sometimes 60 and 70% female students versus male students in the classroom. I think that if female chefs want to keep their place at the stove, it requires a redistribution of the work that happens outside of the kitchen. So it means having either a supportive partner who's willing to take on a lot of the childcare duties. As hospitality evolves, we recognize that a healthier work-life balance in general, not just gender-based, but human-based, is emerging. And so I think that the possibilities are becoming a lot more vast in terms of being able to be a strong female force in the kitchen. I have worked in kitchens that are predominantly female, and some of my observations, my own personal anecdotal observations around that, have been that there's a lot more collaboration in those kitchens and an openness to perhaps a less rigid way of doing things, which, you know, may bode well for future structures within the profession. In the college, we are now experiencing a very exciting time. So we've started a massive renovation. We are currently in the finishing stages of our first bake lab. So we're getting a fully renovated bake lab with 16 workstations for students. We're also building a pastry and chocolate lab. And so students are going to be able to produce some of the more delicate items in a climate-controlled environment. The Loyalist Market is where we sell the prepared baked goods and cooked items that the students make. And once that section is finished, we're going to be building the new restaurant. The new restaurant is going to be overlooking the back area of the college, the beautiful natural environment. We're going to have a huge patio that overlooks that area. And the restaurant is going to be called Nourish. So we came up with this name because we recognize that the work we're doing here at the college involves nourishing not only minds, but bellies and communities. And so we're really looking at this renovation as an opportunity to connect with the community in a more meaningful way. We recognize that the hospitality sector in the county has, in Quinte West, has developed significantly over the last several years, and we really want to be a meaningful piece of the training and skills development that is required to move this forward. And so in this facility, we're going to be able to host tastings and new releases of wines and beers and ciders and spirits and all the incredible things that our local partners are producing. But we're also going to be able to offer skills training. So things like barista training, front of house training, all of the things that complement the existing culinary skills that we already teach. We recognize that students who can not only cook but are proficient at baking are becoming increasingly valuable in the labor force. So a lot of restaurants can't afford to have both a pastry chef as well as a chef. And so, you know, we're really trying to turn out a graduate that is able to do both of those things. And so this is part of why within our programming we added what we call an advanced bake component. So what this is an area of study where we train the students to cook beyond what the ministry outcomes are, let's say. So we really allow them to get some practice time in the kitchen with some of the yeasted dough, some of the sort of finer pastry work, some of the finer chocolate work, and support an individual's skills development who can sort of span the tasks that would be involved in both of those stations. And so the new facility is going to be able to support that learning in a much more meaningful way. I would say that teaching has been the most fulfilling chapter so far of my career. I get to not only still cook, but work with students and see the light bulb go on as they develop their own culinary skills. So couldn't be happier to be here.
Wow, thank you so much to Chef Karen for that amazing demonstration. You can find out more about how you can expand on your culinary skills at loyalistcollege.com. Well, next we have an amazing nutritionist and personal trainer, Rose Reisman. Rose is an award-winning entrepreneur, caterer, author, and media personality. As a registered nutritional consultant and certified personal trainer, armed with an MBA, Rose has taken her passion for healthy living and developed it into a multifaceted enterprise, making her one of Canada's leading authorities on the art of living and eating well. With decades of industry experience, countless media appearances, and 22 cookbooks to her name, Rose is affectionately known as Canada's cookbook queen. Rose started her career in her 30s after she was diagnosed with high cholesterol. From a family with a genetic predisposition towards heart issues, Rose's passion for nutrition stemmed from a personal desire to help other families like hers, showing them how to make small changes to optimize their health without sacrificing the joy of delicious food. Rose holds a Bachelor of Education from the University of Toronto, an MBA from York University, and a Master's in Fine Arts, specializing in theater. Excelling in the fields of communication, business, and stage presence, Rose used her impressive educational background and effective communication skills to help thousands of Canadians adopt healthier lifestyles. In the early 90s, Rose wrote a breakthrough cookbook entitled Rose Reisman Brings Home Light Cooking, selling over 400,000 copies. In the mid-2000s, she pioneered the health menu at restaurant chain The Pickle Barrel and collaborated with McCain's in a commercial promoting healthy alternatives, and also consulted for President's Choice on their blue menu items to devise healthy recipes. Over 30 years, 22 cookbooks, and hundreds of media appearances later, Rose is a household name across Canada. Today, Rose has turned her passion for nutrition into a renowned and far-reaching enterprise with several companies operating under her likeness and guidance, including Rose Reisman Catering, providing healthy cuisine catering for over 400 corporate and social clients. Rose Reisman Personal Gourmet, a fresh and frozen meal delivery program. And the acclaimed Kids Lunch Program, the preferred vendor of the Toronto District School Board, providing hot and healthy meals to schools in the GTA, serving over 1,500 children daily. Rose was recently named Now Magazine's Best Nutritionist in their Reader's Choice 2021 edition.
Hi, I'm Rose Reisman, and today I'd like to talk about my career and how I got started and thrilled to be a part of the Canadian Artistic Food Expo. So, I mean, I started out as a teacher, not as a chef, not as a cookbook author, but I found that I really had a love for food and I used to cook just to de-stress myself. I discovered that I wanted to write a cookbook. Now, if anybody knows anything about publishing, you know that that is not an easy feat by any means. So I did a poll of a cookbook I wanted to publish, which was on desserts, sent it out to a zillion publishers, got a couple bites, but I was nobody, meaning my name didn't mean anything to anyone in this city, maybe except my mother. So what I decided I had to do was self-publish, and that's risky. I don't advise it because you can lose a lot of money, but I took the risk, self-published my first 2-3 cookbooks, which sold mediocre, but I did break even. And then I discovered that my health, my cholesterol was going up because I cooked high fat, butter, cream, dozens of eggs. I loved it, but my family history was stricken with heart disease, high blood pressure, diabetes, not a good thing, and obesity. So I decided I had to change my ways. So I did that by starting to just look at my own eating habits, clean up my own eating habits, and I went, ooh, a light bulb went off. Why don't I write a book on healthier eating? And in 1993, that's really when my career really began. I wrote a book called Rose Risen Brings Home Light Cooking, and I hooked up with the Canadian Breast Cancer Foundation, which I decided to associate with because I wanted to raise funds. There were too many women, young women, being stricken with breast cancer, and I thought if I could raise funds and teach people how to eat well, that would be just a fantastic combination. Wrote that book and sold 750,000 copies, and never looked back. And I continued writing, raising money, and raised about $1 million for breast cancer research over a period of 4 to 5 years. From there, I launched into setting up a cooking school. And I did so just because I realized I had a lot to tell people. I wanted to teach people that you could actually feel better and be healthier if you ate differently. And it wasn't about deprivation. It wasn't about starving yourself. It was just about making better choices and educating yourself. From there, I got a TV show on the Life Network called Lighten Up with Rose Risen. And I had a TV show that was broadcast across Canada. I had different guests on, and just again, finding the newest research in what constitutes good health in terms of food. From there, launched a catering company. Now we're up to about 2004. And we were educating corporate clients how to eat better. Enough of all these, you know, corned beef pastrami sandwiches, you know, mayonnaise, tons of butter, Caesar salads. I had to teach people there was a better way to eat. And we ended up having literally a couple of hundred different clients that we catered to. From there, we developed a line called Personal Gourmet, which was breakfast, lunch, dinner items that could be packaged, sent to your home. It was like a food plan, like a HelloFresh, but we cooked it up for you. And we then launched a children's program. So we were serving about 2,000 kids a day in Toronto, healthier lunches. So I was just thrilled. I loved my work, loved my career, educating people. And it meant a lot to me to teach people basically healthier eating skills. Sold my company, Rose Risen Catering, in, oh my goodness, 2020, just before COVID hit. And as we all know, restaurant hospitality business had a really rough time for 2 years. So I broke away, and I have remained as a consultant to the company called Recipe, where I advise on healthier eating. And from there, I've decided to launch into social media. So you can catch me at Rose Risen on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. And now what I'm doing is creating my own little like TV series where I educate people on a daily basis on how to eat better, and just realize that no matter what you read out there, it's all about how you feel, how healthy you are, because that's what gives you quality of life. So people always ask me, Rose, do you really think that you're gonna live longer because you eat better and take care of yourself? And I say, no guarantees in life, as we all know, but today when I wake up, I definitely feel better than most taking care of my health. So I advise you to look up my website, just go to @RoseRisen, figure out what you wanna do with your life in terms of health and career. And especially as a woman, you can have it all, takes a lot of work, but I wish you all great success in whatever you do. And again, you can reach me at Rose Risen. Thank you.
And thank you so much, Rose, for joining us today. We're thrilled that you were able to be part of this show. Well, our next guest is Valerie Azinge, who is a best-selling cookbook author and the founder of My Digital Kitchen, a dessert catering company and food blog. Her recipes and photos have attracted awareness and followings from reputable celebrity chefs like Gordon Ramsay, as well as features and followings from the Food Network, BuzzFeed, CBC, CTV, and several notable Canadian and international publications.
Hi everyone, my name is Valerie Azinge. I am the founder of My Digital Kitchen. I run a dessert catering company. I am a food blogger, I'm a cookbook author, and also a wine and coffee aficionado. And I am based in Toronto, Ontario. And I'm very grateful to Artists and Artisans and Saffron Hub for giving me the opportunity today to share my story with you guys. So my culinary journey started as far back as 2012. I used to work as a law clerk at a law firm, and my plan was to actually go to law school. However, I started a blog on the side, and I mostly used it to document all of my healthy recipes that would aid in my weight loss journey at the time. One thing led to another. The blog grew as social media became new, particularly Instagram. I started making connections with other people and sharing my love for healthy food. And then I started a following. Part of that following actually contributed to me starting a catering business because I would get a lot of requests to either sell my food or my desserts. And I did realize working in a law firm, there was a huge demand in corporate snacks and healthy eating, but a lot of people would either just order food from their local bakery or fast food areas. And I did realize that this was an opportunity for me to actually introduce my healthier versions of dessert recipes into that field. It kicked off from there, and I decided to open my own dessert catering company. This was also inspired by the fact that I wasn't particularly happy in the field that I was in. I come from a family of lawyers, and I thought it was my path to also become a lawyer. However, it didn't quite fit into my DNA. So I was very fortunate to find that I had a talent for food, and I just dived right into it, and it was such a blessing to me. And several years down the line, I have a dessert catering business. I have an amazing food blog where I share a variety of healthy recipes for all dietary types. I'm a best-selling cookbook author, and I may also have my own line of spices coming to a grocery store near you. So my main niche is simply healthy, good food. I actually go by a quote that I use all the time, which is healthy food plus boring equals myth. That's simple because good food doesn't have to be unhealthy, and healthy food doesn't have to taste bad. So whether it's your favorite desserts or even some favorite fast food options, I always create a healthy spin on it. So for all dietary types, whether you're gluten-free, whether you're vegan, whether you're keto, low carb, or you're just simply looking for ways to just healthify some of your favorite dishes, that's basically where I come in. So my biggest inspiration is my mother. My mother actually started, first of all, my mother is a fantastic cook, and my mother used to be a housewife and then started a catering business and eventually made her way to law school. I do find that in many ways our paths are quite similar, except we did take different directions where she did push her catering culinary business aside and pursued a law degree, while I did the opposite. I pushed my law aspirations aside and pursued the culinary world. She has been very supportive of me through and through, and I do believe I probably got some of her genetic cooking skills passed down to me. I was never really in the kitchen watching her cook and helping and learning from her. I wish I could say that. I was mostly there to eat, but I do find that in many ways she does inspire me to continue to pursue what I love and to just really enjoy good food. So when I'm not working, I actually enjoy relaxing activities. Part of that is reading. I love reading nonfiction and fiction. I also love catching up on my favorite TV shows. I love going out to several restaurants and trying different cuisine. I'm also learning how to play the guitar, so I also do that in my spare time, especially during COVID. That was a habit that I actually picked up during COVID, and I've been enjoying it so far. On a grander scale, I love to travel. I absolutely love traveling and learning about new cultures. I'm actually heading to Europe in a couple of months, and I'll be shooting a documentary in the wine region, in the Chianti region in Italy. So that's also something that I love to do. When I get a chance to travel, I like to try new things and explore the food and wine scene in those areas. So a key lesson I have learned on my journey being an entrepreneur and being a chef is that everything takes time. As cliche as that sounds, it's so true. You're going to have a lot of obstacles. You're going to hit a lot of roadblocks. You're going to have uncertainties. You're going to have ups and downs. You're even going to have friends and family doubt you at first, mostly because they may be worried about your well-being. But I promise you, if you stick with it and you have the true passion, you can accomplish anything in your preferred field. You also need to be patient. Results take time and success is ongoing. But we live in a world that has a lot of resources that caters to basically everyone's needs. And as long as you're able to tap into those resources, you can absolutely accomplish anything that you want to do. With my love and passion for traveling, a country that I've been to that I find has a rich culinary heritage would be Thailand. I was in Thailand a few years ago and I found the food to be amazing. I'm not talking about restaurants or bars, I'm literally talking about street food. Everything is cooked fresh, everything is picked fresh, everything is seasoned perfectly, and it's also very cheap and affordable. And of course, since everything is fresh, it's very healthy to eat. They have a lot of flavors and a lot of diversity with their cooking, and I just found it to be remarkable, accessible, and wonderful. I actually have a few recipes in my cookbook inspired by my trip to Thailand. One of the demos you're going to see on this would be my chicken tahini satay recipe. It's absolutely delicious, and it also takes only 30 minutes to make, and it's also low carb. The best advice I can give a home cook looking for dinner ideas is to simply keep it simple. Whether you live by yourself or you have a small family, all you have to do is pick a protein, pick a carb and a vegetable, and you're good to go. In a lot of cases, you can combine all three things in the sheet pan and it's good to go in about 30 minutes. And of course, if you're looking for more dinner ideas, my cookbook is also available at bookstores and online. It's called 30 Minute Low Carb Dinners, and you can get over 100 different recipes of dinner inspiration. But yes, dinners are usually very easy to make. And if you keep it simple, again, just getting a protein, a carb, and a vegetable, a lot of them can be made on the skillet or can be baked in a sheet pan. And you have a wonderful and easy quick dinner for yourself and or your family. My story ends here for now. Thank you to artists and artisans and to Saffron Hub for giving me a chance to tell my story. If you want to connect with me, I'm on Instagram and Twitter and Facebook at My Digital Kitchen, and I look forward to getting to connect with you guys and continue to share my passion for all things good and healthy food.
Thank you, Valerie, and thanks very much to all of you for joining us online today. I wanted to take a quick second before moving on to thank our amazing team that worked behind the scenes to bring this event to life. Shireen Mandani, Sahar Rahman, Jessica Lemire, Tiana Bogdanovich, Jasjeet Kaur, Gloria Gift Nankunda, Brian Kizala, Alexandra Khanna, Sophie Freyrin, Amelia Papikonomu, Emily Platter, Melissa Barr, and Gurpreet Kaur. To have access to exclusive content and be sure to be the first to know about our next events, make sure to follow us on our social media platforms. Our Facebook pages are Artists and Artisans Development Network and Saffron Hub, and on Instagram at Artists and Artisans Network and at Saffron_Hub Official. Well, who doesn't like shawarma? Next, we have a local restaurant which started from a humble beginning and now has multiple chains. Shawarma Plus. Assam Gabra and Bharat Kudir opened the first Shawarma Plus quick service restaurant in 2012. 1 year later, they were joined by Jawad Gabra, who in 2016 helped the group launch their second restaurant in the heart of Waterloo. With a 1,000 square foot kitchen, this location helped Shawarma Plus scale to regional leader status through catering, large orders, and late night delivery services. Today, this Tri-City favorite has become an award-winning icon amongst shawarma lovers and foodies. They're now ready to bring the Shawarma Plus brand to several other cities in Ontario and beyond over the next few years.
Plus founders, Asim Gabra and Jawad Gabra. My family are of Syrian origin, growing up in UAE before moving to Canada in 2007. My parents, Asim Gabra and Bharat Khudir, opened the first Shawarma Plus quick service restaurant in 2012. One year later, they were joined by Jawad Gabra, who in 2016 helped the group launch their second restaurant in the heart of Waterloo. This location helped to scale to regional leader status through catering large orders and late-night delivery services. Today, this Tri-City favorite has become an award-winning icon amongst shawarma lovers and foodies. We are now ready to bring the Shawarma Plus brand several other cities in Ontario and beyond over the next few years. Inspiration. For years after we immigrated to Canada, our family would host friends for traditional Syrian dinners and they would often ask when we would open our own restaurant. My father always wanted to start a food business as he was very familiar with catering for his family and friends. In 2012, we made this dream a reality by opening a small quick-serve restaurant called Shawarma Plus. Leveraging our father's eye for detail and commitment to quality and our mother's unbeatable touch in the kitchen, we aim to bring the freshest, highest quality and most flavorful traditional Syrian foods to our customers. The results speak for themselves, as we are the most awarded Syrian, Middle Eastern and shawarma store in Ontario. Our customers love us and so will you. Dishes we cook. Our menu used to be huge at the beginning with many traditional Syrian cuisines as well as shawarma and falafel, hence the name, Shawarma Plus. We used to make dishes like stuffed vine leaves, maluba, rice and eggplants topped with minced meat and nuts, fateh makdous, which is small eggplants carved and stuffed with minced meat and onions, cooked with a tomato base, and layered with salty yogurt, fried pita chips, ghee, and pine seeds. Currently, we focus on making everything and seasoning in-house, chicken and beef shawarma, vegetarian falafels, hummus, and salads to name some. Simply what really inspires us is using fresh ingredients to offer a high-quality meal that brings a smile on customers' faces. Childhood favorite meals. One of my favorite dishes is fateh makdous, eggplants. I can't resist eggplants and every time people try it, they rave about it and it becomes the talk of the meeting. Inspiring chefs. There are many including Anthony Bourdain who traveled the world and shared the stories of restaurants, cultures and the livelihood of restaurant operators. I am also a big fan of Gordon Ramsay and his various food shows. Our customers shall expect a welcoming atmosphere that is trendy, eye-catching, yet very chill for them to grab a quick, healthy, fresh halal shawarma bite. Our food is flavorful, delicious and suits the taste buds of most guests and is in the price range of $10-15. Our turnaround times are among the fastest in the food industry and specifically shawarma. Our menu is extremely simple to order from and same would apply for our state-of-the-art technology online ordering menu. Visit shawarmaplus.com for details. The beginning. We started in 2012 in Waterloo and currently opening our Mississauga location in late August 2022. We started franchising October 2021 and currently working with franchisees to open locations across Ontario. There are currently identified locations coming to London, Mississauga, Brampton, Kitchener, and Kirkland Lake. Accomplishments. The ability to satisfy thousands of customers over the past decade and to grow the business from a simple idea with one location to many locations offering quality food at a reasonable budget-friendly price point. The second big accomplishment was being awarded as the number one chef in Waterloo region by the Record Reader Awards in 2020. Not to forget that the restaurant has over 58 awards in the past decade by different bodies from newspapers to universities, etc. My hobbies. I enjoy spending time with family, barbecue, fishing, playing or watching soccer, and meeting new people. Working through the pandemic. We have done many things during the pandemic, such as introducing new family meals, free deliveries, simplified our online ordering systems, and lots of daily marketing. We also worked with other local restaurants and started marketing their offerings on our social media pages. Not to forget working closely with the Food Bank of Waterloo Region. We also worked with other local restaurants and started marketing their offerings on our social media pages. And we work closely with the Food Bank of Waterloo Region. Supporting small business. There are many ways to support, including 1. Positive word of mouth, 2. Leaving a positive review, a post on social media, 3. Being patient and understanding when restaurants are busy, 4. Ordering directly from the restaurant rather than third-party apps, 5. Smiling and thanking the hardworking employees at the restaurant. Learnings. Always be humble, use fresh high-quality ingredients as it will make your products stand out, teamwork makes magic, and get to know your customers and their wants. Favorites to cook. I love spending time on the barbecue with some fat lamb chops. Trips and experiences. I traveled a lot and I believe I came across amazing food operators, cuisines, natural ingredients, spices and herbs in Thailand, Malaysia, Nepal, and Sri Lanka. I am a huge fan of Asian and Southeast Asian food. Future meals. There are many ideas that we are testing in the kitchen, but definitely some plant-based meals is one of them. Ingredients I use regularly: black pepper, garlic, cinnamon, oranges and lemon. Cooking tips. Go to Instagram or get a cooking book off the shelf or simply talk to someone in the restaurant industry who are usually foodies. Don't be shy to try and have some messy food fun in the kitchen. Call me as I will be happy to join. New normal. I would love to see stability across the world, peace, and the ability to be positive and optimistic about the future. Toronto and GTA favorite spots. There are many restaurants I enjoy visiting, including Pai for Thai Asian cuisine, Gladiator Burgers, Jumer Restaurant for Iraqi food. The list is quite big for a foodie like me. Last words. Thank you to Saffron Hub as well Artist and Artisans Development Network for letting us share our story. Jawad Gabra from Shawarma Plus.
Well, our next guest is Chef Bruce Dove from Riversong, which is a beautiful country location. They host banquets, weddings, and any other special event you'd like to have, up to 100 people. They also have a cafe open to the public for breakfast and lunch, and host both private and public cooking classes.
Hey everybody, it's Chef Dove, that's me. And I'm here to hang out with you for a few minutes. So thanks so much for having me. Today we're going to actually make some Greek chicken. But before we get into that, I'm gonna talk to you a little bit about myself. I love talking about myself, it's the best. Anyways, I own and operate a place that's called Chef Duff at Riversong. And it is, I don't wanna say in the middle of nowhere, it is out in the country. That sounds a little bit nicer. So it's very, very appealing. We're just outside of St. Jacobs, Ontario. So it's a great little quaint location. We are very casual kind of atmosphere, but we also make very fine cuisine at the same time. So it's just a great combination of both things. What do we do there? Well, we're a banquet hall, so we're able to host functions for you, whether it's a corporate event, whether it's a Christmas party, whether of course it's a wedding, birthday parties, anniversaries, we can do all of that kind of stuff. We also run a cafe during the week, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. And we're open for breakfast and lunch so to the public, which is amazing. And we also do special events that are also available to the public, such as cooking classes, special events like a barbecue night maybe, or maybe we do a fish and chips night, or we do special things like that that you can just come in and sign up for or reserve a table for, or that kind of thing. So that's basically what we're all about. So it's pretty awesome. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to talk a little bit about Greek food. I'm just going to kind of put my frying pan on a low flame here just so it'll kind of slowly warm up, because right now it's cold. I know it's cold because I can touch it with my hands and it doesn't burn me. Once it's nice and hot, then I won't be able to do that because it'll really hurt, so it's not really ideal. But anyways, we're going to make just a little Greek chicken recipe, very, very simple, not really too much ingredients in it other than, guess what, chicken. Greek food is very, very popular. It kind of incorporates not a lot of ingredients, just like maybe an Italian dish would. Just simple, fresh flavors They're on the Mediterranean coast, and that's basically what they're what it's all about. So I'm just gonna take my chicken here, and we're just gonna butterfly it. What's involved with that is I just take my knife parallel to the cutting board, and I literally just go back and forth, comme ça, and we just cut it in half like that, and we just butterfly it open like that. Not like the butterflies that fly around in the garden, not that kind of butterfly. Just like something we call that when we open up our chicken and make it all nicey-nicey like that, okay? So with Greek food, we do very simple seasoning. So we're gonna do just some very basic seasoning on here. Wow, that makes a loud noise when you put that down. And we're just gonna use some salt. What kind of salt? Sea salt, obviously, because it's on the Mediterranean, right? Makes sense. A little fresh ground pepper, a little bit of oregano, okay? Pretty straightforward. Just put a little bit on there. And then we flip her over like that. And we do the same thing on the other side. A little salt, oregano, and a little pepper, okay? So far, so good, right? Pretty straightforward. Nobody can mess that up, right? Then we're just gonna get our frying pan. We're gonna throw a little bit of olive oil in here. It's funny you see any Mediterranean recipes or a lot of Mediterranean recipes that call for oil of some kind, they'll ask for olive oil. So you gotta think about that when you live here in Ontario, because olive oil is very expensive here. You don't always necessarily need to use it. They always call for that in a recipe because that's what they have there. It's available to them. It's cheap for them in those countries, but here it's expensive. For example, I would never put olive oil in a deep fryer. That's an example of a situation where I wouldn't use it in Ontario. Anyways, oh, did you hear that? That's always exciting when it goes because it means it's cooking. So we actually have our flame on a fairly high, what I call medium high temperature, just to get this going. We're going to kind of sear this chicken breast a little bit, get some color on it. And I'm just gonna ask my assistant to pass me a clean cutting board and a knife because I don't wanna use the same board that we had the chicken on, and it's just a whole thing that way. Look at this, great teamwork here. Wow, how about that? Thank you so much. So, as my chicken's cooking, I just wanna get a little bit of color on it. And as you can see, it has some beautiful color on it. That's basically how we start that off. Fairly straightforward, and it's gonna start to turn this down a little bit so that it doesn't get cooked too fast, and that'll be all good. Now, Greece is an interesting country because it's on the Mediterranean and there's all these like inlets and all of that, so even though the perimeter doesn't seem that big, there's actually so much coastline because of all the little perimeters and such. At the same time, the internal part of Greece is 80% of Greece is actually mountains. That's pretty wild, eh? Which makes sense. That's why Zeus would have picked Greece as a place to be born. That's where Mount Olympus is, right? So that all kind of makes sense if you think about it that way, right? So there we go. So there's our chicken. It's just nicely browned on both sides, okay? Just like that. I'm just taking it out of the pan for a second. All I'm gonna do with this is just take some fresh garlic. I'm gonna take some fresh garlic, just slice it up a little bit. And then we're just gonna literally just pop that into the frying pan, okay? And then all we're gonna do is just soften up our garlic a smidge in the frying pan. Right? Easy. How hard can that be, right? We just wanna soften it up a smidge without really it taking on an extremely amount of color. Now our chicken's gonna go back in here. That's pretty good. Then we're gonna take some lemon. A little bit of lemon. We're gonna throw our lemon in there. In Greece, in Canada, this is what we do. We have salt and pepper always on the table. In Greece, what they do is they actually do the opposite. They have olive oil and lemon, and they use that on the table to season their food. So we have this going. Now we're just gonna put a little bit of white wine, just a smidge of white wine in there, okay? Very, very little white wine, okay? Just enough to, you know, drown your chicken a little bit, okay? So that's basically gonna simmer in there and turn it down to a dull roar there. Then we're gonna take our lid. Oh look, it's just another frying pan. Well, that's what we do in kitchens, is we just put whatever we have lying around we can use as a lid, and that's just going to simmer away in there for a few minutes, right? What's important when you use the wine is to is not to measure it, right? That's very, very important, okay? So we're gonna let that simmer away for a couple of minutes, and then we're gonna flip it over, and then we're gonna finish it off, and you're not even gonna believe it. It's gonna be so fantastic, right? So Greece, they use a lot of things like garlic, lemon, olive oil, oregano, other fresh herbs. That's a lot of the kind of stuff they use for seasonings, for flavorings. And those combination of ingredients are like, woo, they're unbelievable. They're so awesome, okay? So that's simmering away very nicely for a couple of minutes there. Then I'm gonna flip it over to the other side. And this chicken's gonna be so very, very tender. You're not even gonna believe how tender this chicken is gonna be. So we're just gonna continue simmering that for a couple of minutes. Okay, so I'm just gonna show you how we're gonna finish off our chicken now. Everybody excited? So it's been just simmering away for a couple of minutes. We've got a little bit of nice liquid in there. Really awesome. My garlic's just softened up in there. It's pretty beautiful. I just have it on very low now. Just let it kind of simmer nice and slow. We're just gonna finish it off with a little bit of fresh herbs here. Okay, let those all go in the pan. Beautiful, right? Everybody agrees? Good, I'm glad you agree. Wonderful. Then we just take a little bit of fresh butter to finish this off. And we just mix the butter through here. That's cold butter, by the way, not melted butter. If I throw melted butter in here, I'm gonna make something really greasy, okay? This is just nice, fresh butter, and it's gonna make this liquid really nice and creamy, okay? One more butter, right? Can never have enough butter. Okay, and we mix that all up nicey. Just let it kind of blend through there. And it's beautiful. Then we just take a nice plate, kamsa. And we throw our chicken on there. We throw this nice little butter sauce on top. Don't want to waste any of it. Okay, beautiful. Whoa! Okay, and then a little bit of fresh tomato on there. And that's a beautiful Mediterranean Greek chicken. Please come and see us here in St. Jacobs. The website is www.chefduff.ca. So easy. Check out what's going on the website, all the different things that we have, the cooking classes, our functions, our different events, our cafe. Wow, there's so much stuff to do and see here. So we just want to give a big shout out to our friends at Saffron Hub for putting this on and inviting me to join you today. See you later.
Well, thank you, Chef Duff, for that delicious Mediterranean chicken recipe. Well, next we welcome Courtney and Arjun, who started Nutty Hero to share their passion for health and wellness and to have a positive impact on their community. Nutty Hero nut and seed butters are handmade in small batches using a mix of 12 elite nuts and seeds and 100% natural ingredients, creating the yummiest and healthiest all-natural nut and seed butters is their passion. The big picture mission for them is to give back and have a positive impact on our community. 2% of all their sales go towards funding meal donations through food banks and planting trees. Here is Courtney.
Hello, my name is Courtney. I am the co-founder of Nutty Hero, which is a mixed nut and seed butter company that my husband and I launched back in September of 2021. It's been absolutely insane seeing this business grow so quickly to bring it to where we are today in more than 40 stores across Ontario and Canada and expanding. We've really created this 12 nut and seed butter here, which is something that we created for ourselves initially. We're both athletes. We like to run and do lots of outdoor activities like hiking. and we wanted something that would be convenient and tasty to incorporate into our diets. Every morning I would make a smoothie and I would bring out hemp and flax and chia and all these different nuts and seeds and mix it into my smoothie, and it was time consuming. So we wanted to create something that had all of these things in it that would be convenient and tasty, which is where our Nutty Hero 12 Nut and Seed Butter was born. We have a really interesting brand. You can see here, our logo is a squirrel with a cape. That's our Nutty Hero. We wanted to have fun with it, so we created some different flavor profiles like our coconut crunch, honey vanilla, chocolate bliss, and maple cinnamon here. So all of these things are bringing smiles to people's faces because our logo is just a little bit quirky, and also having fun with some of our flavors here. So that was really important to us when we were building out our company. And also, because we made these for ourselves, we wanted to make these as healthy as possible. So there's no more than 2 grams of sugar per serving for all of them. And we are using all natural ingredients as well and going local when possible. So my favorite is the chocolate bliss here. I like to eat it on different fruits, strawberries, bananas. These are also really good in oatmeal, in smoothies, on top of pancakes, things like that. We have a recipe blog with lots of interesting ways that you can eat them, incorporate them into your diet. But honestly, it's a home run recipe. It took us 10 months to build these recipes. We would create a recipe, send it out to our sampling team, get information, collect all of that, take that information back, and then recreate the recipes, tweak them, and we went back and forth and did that until we landed on something that we were absolutely in love with. So here you can see the consistency of the chocolate bliss one here, which is nice and drizzly with a little texture. It's delicious. Absolutely delicious on strawberries. So if you want to buy Nutty Hero, you can go to nuttyhero.com, purchase it online. You can also check out our store locator to see which stores are located near you, which you might be able to purchase these products from. And I just want to say a special thank you to Saffron Hub and Artist and Artisans Development Network and Canadian Artistic Food Expo 2022 for including us in their programming. And just want to sign off with my favorite way to eat the Nutty Hero. Amazing.
Well, thank you very much, Courtney. And as we introduce our chefs and restaurants, you'll be surprised to see the amazing lineup of celebrity chefs this year. For those who watch the Great Canadian Baking Show, you would have seen Chef Rofikat, a self-taught baker who immigrated to Canada in 2017 and went on to compete and win season 4 of the Great Canadian Baking Show. She's currently host of Rofikat's Better Bake Along on CBC Gem. We thank her for making this special video for us.
Hello, my name is Rofikat Oyawoyi Salami. I am originally from Nigeria, but now live in Milton, Ontario, Canada, and I am a home baker. I was inspired to be a baker by my mom. She used to allow us to help her out whenever she was making something in the kitchen, and we're able to help her with mixing things and arranging things on maybe cakes and cookies and things like that. And it inspired me to want to do it on my own. So when I was in university, I started baking on my own and I haven't stopped baking since then. So most of the things I make are, I make lots of cakes and cookies and pastries. Those are my favorite things to eat. And I also like experimenting with fine French pastries and such things as well. One of the things I used to have as a child that I still enjoy making now are meat pies. They hold a very special memory for me because we used to have them on road trips. For instance, whenever we were going to on a road trip, there was a particular stop halfway where we would stop and get some meat pies and soft drinks for the rest of the trip. And being able to make them for myself is a very special thing that I really enjoy doing. So a meat pie is basically a handheld flaky pastry filled with seasoned meat and vegetables, and it's really, really good. And it holds a lot of special memories for me, and I enjoy making it now for myself and for my family. There are lots of people in the baking space that inspire me, too many to name. Anna Olsen being one of them, also Nadia Hussein. There are so many bakers that inspire me to want to be like them and try to challenge myself and become more than I already do when I bake. So my biggest achievement as a baker was auditioning for and being selected to be on, and then finally winning season 4 of the Great Canadian Baking Show in 2020. That was one of my biggest achievements as a baker, and it kind of validated for me that baking is something that I actually do know how to do. So I encourage anyone that has any such passion to pursue it and stick with it. Don't give up and always challenge yourself. I feel like if you challenge yourself, the only thing you can do is if you fail, you learn from the failure, and there's absolutely nothing wrong with that. I enjoy baking and cooking because I feel like food is a love language. It's a way of showing someone that you care. As a matter of fact, it's jokingly said that in Nigeria, when somebody asks, "Have you eaten?" it's their way of saying, "I love you." So I really enjoy cooking and baking for my family, for my friends, sharing things I've made with them, and knowing that this thing that I've made is able to give pleasure to someone is just a feeling that I really enjoy. So there are some dishes that I'm hoping to be able to make. I have not been able to make a successful baguette, but I am hoping. I'm hoping one day to be able to build up the courage to try to make a successful one. But for the meantime, I'm just trying my hand out at really complicated, multi-element French pastries, desserts that have different layers and textures and flavors to them that require planning and putting different flavors together. So those are the things I'm working on currently. During the pandemic, I've just been staying on top of what's going on in the culinary baking world, following lots of accounts with interesting ideas, trying to see which one of those I can recreate in my home kitchen, and basically just perfecting the things I already know how to do and trying my hand out at new things. So my biggest baking tip, if you are starting out as a baker or you want to get into baking, is the very first time you try something, don't make any changes. Baking is very finicky, it can be quite demanding, and it really does require you to know what each ingredient does before you start changing it. So I would advise that when you are making a recipe, a baking recipe for the first time, don't make any changes, bake it as is, and then after you taste it and you see how it comes out, you can now evaluate what each ingredient does and how you would like to substitute it. So for instance, you might feel like you wanted it to be a little lighter, it wasn't light enough, it was too dense, and you might decide to add a little bit more baking powder to it. Or you felt like maybe the flavor was a bit flat, you might want to increase the amount of salt in it or something like that. So when you are baking, stick with the recipe for the first time until you are sure of what each ingredient does. It's been really lovely talking to you. Thank you very much for listening, and enjoy the rest of the expo.
Well, thank you, Chef Rofikat. Well, next we have Chef Erica Araujo, a trained nurse from Mexico City who found her passion for gastronomy once she immigrated to Canada. She completed the culinary program at Humber College, and since then she's been tirelessly promoting Mexican culture and cuisine through her brand, Iksim, at workshops, food demonstrations, as a host of TV programs, team building cooking events, online workshops worldwide as a breakout teacher, and events like Taco Fest, Recipe for Change, Soupalicious, the Pan American Food and Music Festival, Tequila Fest, and Cheese Grill Challenge. She's also a vendor at Junction and Montgomery's in farmers markets and a philanthropist cooking to fundraise money for good causes. She's a promoter of Mexican culture, and following her roots, she brought the tradition of the authentic gastronomy to Canada, as well as bringing the history to her dishes, and her heritage is reflected in her cooking.
Hello.
Food is traditionally something that brings us all together. Culture, agriculture. We think of ourselves as proud Oosters. We're proud of what we do. We have the pride of the artisan. We want to have a direct contact with our customers. So we don't try to proselytize or sell. On the first level of entry, someone can buy our chocolate bar or drink our chocolate drink. And in so doing, they're supporting our social enterprise. They're supporting our creative research and work. They're supporting us. We're going right to the farmers. It takes more work, it takes time to build it, it takes time to grow it. It's organic, right? You know, it's slow food because you don't go from the idea to the packaged product overnight. We situate ourselves most strongly in the Mesoamerican tradition, in the food of the gods. We draw on the European aesthetic of the gods, but only insofar as it doesn't take away from the nutritional, medicinal, and ecological properties of the cacao. And we like to think of the cacao and the chocolate we make as a way of punching a hole in our current food system. Then you see the industrialization of cacao. And there, the cacao, in a certain sense, is denatured. It's turned from the food of the gods into something that can actually make you sick. It's turned from something that is an expression of ecology into something that has its quintessential candy wrapper and its junk ingredients. Chocolate, the bean, is not a sweet little candy. When you eat a cacao bean, when you see a cacao pod, you actually show people something that surprises them. In that perceptual discord, there's a teachable moment. This is the source and origin of chocolate. And in that process, give them an idea of how much it's been adulterated and how much it's been changed. So chocolate, in that sense, is a vehicle. It's a vehicle for our creativity, it's a vehicle for our expression of our dignity and our creativity, and it's also something that gives us joy. Our work is fun. This is symbolic. It's not just the product, it's the whole community and communities that it takes to make this chocolate come here. Nothing, when you do it this way, makes money overnight. You're planting a seed, you're growing a seedling into a sapling, into a tree that will bear fruit. You know, have this little bite of chocolate, have this little drink of chocolate, and as my mentor Gustavo says, be careful, because in so doing, you're becoming part of a radical political project.
Hola, I'm Chef Erika Araujo, and I'm a promoter of the traditional Mexican gastronomy. And today, I would like to talk to you about the Corn Project. Be part of this project, it really makes me so happy because we make tortillas and tamales inspired by the indigenous tradition in the same way that we make in Mexico. Next tamale involves boiling the corn in an alkaline solution so we make it more digestible. After we wash it, we will use our lava stone mill to make masa. Working in collaboration with Chocosol really gave me the opportunity to continue promoting the corn the tortilla, and a lot of other dishes that are very, very traditional. At the same time that we support using local and seasonal ingredients. The Corn Project really provides customers with nutritious, local, and sustainable food. Come and enjoy the traditional Mexican food, and you will travel to Mexico just in a bite. Thank you to Safran Hub for this opportunity and to Chocosol for the collaboration. Adios!
Well, thank you very much, Chef Erica. And all the way from Vancouver, BC, we have Forest Bean, a sustainable coffee company that supports biodiversity on the founder's sixth-generation family farm in Western Ghats, India. The farm practices agroforestry through growing the coffee beans under large trees instead of cutting down trees, helping to support and preserve wildlife habitats and help maintain biodiversity. They currently offer two coffee roasts, both locally roasted in Vancouver.
Hi. I'm Pete Puvana, the founder and director of Forest Bean Coffee. We bring coffee from our family-owned sixth-generation coffee farm in India. Today, I want to talk about why our farm is sustainable and an eco-friendly farm when compared to the most of the coffee producing regions across the world. But before that, I want to share with you why I started the Forest Bean. In 2013, I moved to Canada to pursue my PhD in sustainable energy engineering. I was really surprised to notice the love for coffee North Americans had. I realized how our addiction is affecting the environment. There are several researchers which shows that for every cup of coffee we drink, 1 square inch of forest, rainforest are destroyed. In most of the coffee producing regions, deforestation is massive because of the coffee farming. Deforestation not only displaces biodiversity, but also displaces indigenous farmers. Monoculture of the coffee farm, of course, increases productivity. The economy of coffee increases. As the economy of the coffee increases, the rainforests are decreasing. Amazon is vanishing. As the environmental crisis deepens, I saw a potential in transforming the current coffee economy into a sustainable economy by producing sustainable coffees. Therefore, I started Forest Bean. Our Forest Bean Coffee Company brings coffee from this sixth-generation-old, family-owned coffee farm. Here, the coffee plants are grown under the shades of the native trees. These native trees are almost 100 years old, and coffees are produced naturally, like a forest-like environment, where animals and birds flourish. Farmers and animals live symbiotically on this farm. Our shade-grown micro-lot farms produce one of the best single-origin Arabica beans, while providing natural habitat for multitudes of birds, animals, bugs, wildcats, and other species. Here on our farm, we have recorded hundreds of floral species, 50 bird types, and countless number of native trees. Tigers, elephants, leopards are common sightings on the farm, including wild cobras, peacocks, wild boars are native to this habitat. As you all can notice here on the farm, it is not a monoculture, it is a multiculture with mixed crops. Along with the coffee, there is black pepper also. This is called as one of the golden crops on the farm, black pepper. And there are jackfruit trees, there are bananas, there are vanilla plants here, there are native avocado plants, a number of fruits on the farm. It is a multi-crop farm. These coffees are produced on a very high altitude ranges here, almost 6,000 foot plus. This range is called Western Ghats Ranges, which is one of the UNESCO World Heritage Site. The coffees grown here are special because it is produced on a micro lot farm, single origin coffee beans, on a UNESCO World Heritage Site. We at Forest Bean Coffee Company, we bring the fresh roasted beans to you in this beautiful tin container. This tin container is 100% recyclable, fitted with a one-way valve. The roasted bean continuously emits carbon dioxide, so it can be released outside, but it doesn't take any air inside, so that the coffee roasted beans stays fresh for you. We at Forest Beans cover the entire spectrum of the coffee value chain. We grow the coffee, we source the coffee, and we ship the coffee, roast the coffee, and distribute the coffee as well, so that there is no middleman, and the entire the value and the profit earned goes back onto the farm. This is our model. Friends, I hope you would like this product. It's beautifully designed, and we grow with utmost care, and I hope you will enjoy this product. I request you to support us by buying this coffee. By buying this coffee, you are helping to preserve wildlife and natural environments, as well as contributing to the livelihood of indigenous farmers and artisans. Forest Bean is rainforest, shade-grown coffee hand-picked from a cooperative of microlot farms. We carefully roast them to make an exquisite artisan product. We at Forest Bean strive towards promoting indigenous farming solutions to the environmental and climate crisis by connecting beans to biodiversity. To learn more about the history and the story of Forest Bean, please visit www.theforestbean.com.
Well, thank you very much to Forest Bean for that interesting look at growing coffee beans. Well, everyone enjoys eating ice cream. It's amazing to see how kids of all ages are attracted to ice cream. After all, there is something in ice cream that everyone loves. How do you make an ice cream that does not contain preservatives, stabilizers, or emulsifiers, and yet is so fresh and creamy? Well, inspired to create something unique and pure, Kanwal and Jasjeet created something that everyone would love, including those who cannot tolerate dairy products. At Roly Poly Cow, they strongly believe in offering customers a unique experience of not only enjoying freshly prepared dairy or non-dairy ice cream rolls, but also very special milkshakes, specialty coffees, gourmet cakes, and pastries.
Running wild. trying to set myself free. Lost sight of what was standing right in front of me this time. And all the while, the world, it hit me with the speed of sound. And don't you worry, girl, I'm always gonna be around. Won't battle lash, just like Carter Cat. Just like Carter Cat. Just like Carter Cat. I feel like it never gonna stop. Tunnel vision in my mind. Won't be giving you up this time. No, I'm running wild, trying to set myself free. Lost sight of what was standing right in front of me this time. And all the while, the world, it hit me with the speed of sound. And don't you worry, girl, I'm always gonna be around. Won't battle last, just like Carter and Cash.
What an interesting and creative way of making ice cream. Well, next we have Hanuk Foods by Khadija Hairu. They produce, package, and distribute the best of Nigerian specialty foods and drinks for African food lovers. Just feel the aroma that comes from the foods prepared by them with love.
Welcome to Hanuk Foods. My name is Khadija Hairu and I'm your chef. Making African specialties, especially West African, Nigerian specialties. And I want to welcome you to my world. Thank you to Saffron Hub and Artists and Artisans Network. This is an opportunity to showcase our diversity and I'm very, very pleased and grateful to be here to share with you what I have for you today. Today I'm going to be making Ofada stew, and we're going to be using boiled yams to eat it. This is something that I've tried to offer a while. I said people do not like the idea of too much spice. This is a very spicy sauce that we love in West Africa, especially Nigeria, and I want to show you how it's made. So join me as I take you on this journey. So we poured in every single piece. As you can see, all ready. So we're going to pour this in. We're going to stir it all in. Stir it all in. And this, some people like to do a little bit of a step by step. But this is where I like to put all my spices. So we're adding the Maggi cubes. Okay guys, I like to break them down. Most times I actually use the powdered version. And as you cook them through, you'll find that they actually break. Yeah. And at this point, I'm going to add my crayfish. I'm
And even though I got my kebabs in the oven, it's the last thing I'm gonna add. So basically, just so that this, and what do you know? I forgot to add my imru. So we're gonna do just that because we want it to sip in and just create that really nice flavor. And we're going to put in everything that this wants. Because that is how I like it. At this point, we're also going to put in the eggs. Trust me, a lot of people think too early, but you want the eggs to, you know, just absorb every single bit. Right. We're gonna sprinkle this with some salt, and then we're gonna cover this. For 20 minutes. And I have this on medium heat, so we're gonna have this going on for 20 minutes. See how that goes. Thought I'd use this again. This is really nice, and you can see it's fried down very well. This has been cooking on low heat. We're just gonna simmer it again for about 10 minutes. And it's ready, people. Gonna simmer again for about 10 minutes and it's ready. Okay, I'm gonna plate this quickly. Secret is give it enough oil so it can cook fast enough. It can basically fry. So you're frying peppers, remember that. And so voila! Now if I'm to plate this for myself, yummy. I will go ahead and plate that. And there you have it. Thank you so much for coming on this journey with me. It's Hanak Foods and I'm Khadija Halyu, your chef. I've totally enjoyed just sharing with you one of the simple dishes from Nigeria, Ufada stew, also known as designer stew. You can look this up and I'm telling you, you will not regret it. Try it, it's a very simple way. For those of you who are allergic to tomatoes, who are trying to get, you know, rid of the acidity in your life, I tell you, this is one of the most popular ways you can do it. If you're very sensitive to heat, you can eliminate the heat and use just the sweet peppers, maybe a little chili, and you are off to go. So I'm hoping you've enjoyed watching, and I'd love to hear you try this and send me some comments. Thank you again, Saffron Hub and the Artisan Development Network, for giving me a chance to showcase, and I'll see you again on the other side.
Well, thank you very much, Khadija, for that unique West African dish. Well, I wanted to give one last big thank you to our sponsors, Loyalist College, Belleville Nissan, Leuna Local 183, the City of Belleville, the City of Brampton, and Alexicon for their generous support throughout this event. Well, you can find more about them on our website, artisticfoodexpo.com, and don't forget to follow us on Instagram and like us on Facebook. It has been my pleasure to host this virtual event, and I'd like to thank you sincerely for joining us. It means a lot to all the small businesses, entrepreneurs, and local food organizations throughout Canada that you were with us today. Thanks to all the government officials for their support and messages of encouragement. And we conclude this event with a chef who reminds everyone to be healthy. Chef Siva Swaminathan is the executive chair and one of the founding members of the Diabetes Canada South Asian Diabetes Chapter in Toronto. After being in the IT field for 12 years, she decided to pursue her dream of being a chef by attending the George Brown Culinary Program, where she worked with many Canadian top chefs. She apprenticed in Germany and Switzerland for 2 years, and now operates Chef Siva Cooking School, which offers a variety of cooking classes and services. She was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes 16 years ago, and has been using her culinary skills to develop low GI healthy meal plans for people with diabetes, heart disease, and celiac.
My name is Siva Swaminathan, and we're going to be doing some amazing cooking demo using whole grain for South Asian cooking. So come closer and we'll talk whole grain.
For the South Asian cooking today, we're going to be using this beautiful, beautiful round grain called millet. Okay, we're going to talk about this a little bit closer when we do the demo, but I just wanted to show you what the whole grain looks like. And here we have bulgur. It's also a wonderful, wonderful whole grain. It's from wheat and it's got the whole wheat germ and everything intact. So this is also perfect for ugma. And what we have here is also cracked wheat, which is also perfect for creating ugma. And what we have here is quinoa. Quinoa is also wonderful. It's also a nice whole grain. It's a seed actually, but it's wonderful for creating ugma. And lastly, what we have here is steel cut oats. Steel cut oats are also perfect for creating ugma. It's just you have to watch the water ratio. And also for one of the bonus segment, we're going to be doing steel cut oats for breakfast. So that dish I'm also going to create with steel cut oats, but also you can use the other whole grains I just showed you here to create the breakfast dish. So let's go get started.
Today we're talking whole grains, and we're going to be using millet in place of a lot of times it's whole wheat is used, sometimes different grains are used. Today we're going to use millet. Okay, millet is this wonderful, wonderful grain. It's perfectly round. It looks like quinoa, but it's beautifully round, and we're going to make ugma out of this. So here are the ingredients. For this recipe, we're going to be using the whole grain millet. So we have a cup of mixed vegetables, combination of broccoli, cauliflower, carrots, and all of that. We have a half a cup of millet. We have some curry leaves and red chili, and we have chopped one green chili. We have some cashews, some coriander, half an onion, some grated coconuts, combination of ginger garlic paste, some salt, and we're going to use some of the spice, and then we're going to use one cup of water to cook this.
We just added some mustard seed. We're going to wait for them to temper, so they have to pop. So I'm just going to close the lid. I'm going to wait for them to pop. Now the mustard seeds have popped. We're gonna add half a teaspoon of urad dal, one broken red chili, some curry leaves, onion, green chili, and We're going to saute them really well. We're going to add our ginger and garlic paste. And it smells incredibly, incredibly aromatic. Now we're going to add all our mixed vegetables. Here we have combination of broccoli, cauliflower, green beans, peas, carrots, a bit of corn. So we're just going to saute this a bit. We're going to add half a teaspoon of turmeric. We're just going to use half a teaspoon of salt. Mix really well. Now I'm going to add 1 cup of water. And I'm going to bring it to a boil. I'm going to mix it in. I'm going to cover it for about 10 minutes and let it cook. Okay, now it's been 20 minutes and all the water has been absorbed and the vegetables are beautifully cooked and the millet is beautifully cooked. You can see it's beautifully fluffy and moist. Now I'm just going to sprinkle some coconuts. It's an optional step. And then some chopped coriander. And this is ready to be enjoyed. And we're just going to plate it. The millet umma is ready and beautifully plated. Let's see how it tastes. It's very delicious, healthy. So this is how you would cook millet, whole grain millet umma. This is a bonus recipe today. So we're gonna show how we can use also whole grain for a breakfast, for sort of a South Asian style breakfast. So what we have here is steel cut oats. And steel cut oats are these oats that have been just, you know, cut, but the idea is the grain is still, the whole grain goodness is still intact. So we're going to be using that for breakfast cereal. So this is what you'll need. We have 1/2 cup of steel cut oats. We have 3 cups of water. We're going to be finishing it off with some milk or almond milk or whatever dairy you like to have. We have 1 tablespoon of currants. We have 1 tablespoon of pumpkin seeds, 1 tablespoon of sunflower seeds, some cardamom. That's going to really make this dish aromatic. We're going to use some cinnamon powder, a touch of salt, and we're going to be using the mortar and pestle to kind of pound the cardamom seed to a powder. So this is what the ingredients you will need. So let's see how we can cook this. Recipe, we're just going to be making a beautiful South Asian style steel cut oats for breakfast. So I'm just going to start out with just a tiny knob of butter. We're just going to roast our nuts. So I'm adding the pumpkin seeds, sunflower seeds. I'm just going to give it a mix. While that is roasting, I'm going to pound my cardamom. Aromatic. I'm just going to add it. It already smells wonderful. Now I'm going to add my currants and my steel cut oats. I'm just going to mix them all together. Just a touch of salt. And last but not least, just a dash of cinnamon. So it's just getting nicely dry roasted. I'm going to add about 2.5 cups of water. I'm going to bring it to a boil, and I'm going to gently cook it for about 15 minutes until the water is absorbed. The porridge is cooked and all the water has been absorbed, so it gets to a nice porridge consistency. This looks so good and it smells wonderful. This is so good. It smells wonderful. So I'm going to show how we can plate this. Okay, follow me. To top your cooked steel cut porridge, you have an option of maybe sprinkling a little bit of coconut, some blueberry, some pumpkin seeds, sunflower seeds, and just topping it with a little bit of almond milk. And then let's see how it tastes. This is the bonus segment that we made a breakfast cereal using steel cut oat, bit of a South Asian ingredient like the cardamom and the cinnamon, and looks incredibly amazing. I topped it with some coconut, some pumpkin seeds, and some sesame seeds. Let's see how it tastes. This is really tasty and very filling, and it's whole grain goodness. I'm Siva Swaminathan, and this has been a whole grain food demo. Thank you.